Hey, Harvest, Pastor Jeff Thompson here. So glad for this season when we can, in an increasing way, we can meet with Jesus. And we're going to be talking about that further today. Thanks so much for joining us on these Wednesday check-ins. You know, Scripture says in Hebrews 1:1 that long ago, at many times in many ways, God spoke to our fathers through the prophets. But in these last days, he's spoken to us through his Son. And so today we're going to be talking about the written word that tells us of the living word, Jesus Christ. And so today, I want to tell you a little bit about how I get into God's word. And my goal today isn't to tell you some specific ways that you can access scripture so that you can find a secret code or anything like that. It's just to share some ways, some things that I've learned along the way, and hopefully some of these things are helpful to you. See, I grew up knowing the importance of God's word, but feeling like I couldn't really access myself. It's long. There's parts of it that are complicated and difficult to understand, and many times I felt like, where do I even start? But I determined to learn more about God's word and to learn more about how could I study the Bible for myself. And so as you get into this, as you're maybe you're brand new at studying God's word, or maybe you've been doing it a long time, but wherever you are, recognize that this is a process. So wherever you are in that process, it's okay. And it's amazing to me that, you know, the message of the Bible is so simple that a small child can understand it, and yet it's so intricate and so beautiful that the greatest minds who have ever lived have spent their entire lives delving into this ocean and have never yet found the bottom. So wherever you are, start there, and you can joyfully grow over the years to greater depth in God's word. To the point where your time in God's word isn't drudgery. It's not something that you have to do in order to somehow earn something for yourself. No, it's a chance to meet with Jesus, to learn about the nature of our incredible and majestic and loving God. And it's for sure a spiritual discipline. It's something that you make yourself do so that you can grow to love Jesus more. But the more that you look at your time in God's word as an opportunity, a chance to meet with Jesus, the more it will be life-giving to you. If you've ever heard me talk about this before, you've probably heard me say, have a plan and have a place. Have a plan. You need to plan for your time in God's word or it won't happen. So for me, Monday is a longer time in God's word because it's my day off. And Tuesday through Friday mornings, I'm spending time in God's word. Saturday mornings, I tend to have a men's prayer meeting. So I'm not typically in God's word right away. And then Sunday, we're in God's word together as a community, as a church. So for me, it's those weekdays that I'm really digging into God's word. And my wife and I also spend a little bit of time every night before bed reading a chapter of God's word together. There's lots and lots of great Bible reading plans. Some Bibles have them in the very back of them. You can find them anywhere. Just go to Google and type in Bible reading plans and you'll find one. But whatever the plan that you use, stick to some kind of a plan. Even if it's, I'm going to start in Matthew and keep going until I get to the end of the New Testament. But just having a plan and then having a place. Find a place where you consistently study God's word and meet with him, right? For me, it's there's a chair right here in our library where often I sit and open God's word and study it and pray. And it's like when I'm in that space, my soul knows that it's time to meet with the Lord. And so we're going to do some of that right now. Grab your Bible right now, wherever you are, and turn over to John 15, because I want to share some principles that I use. Again, these aren't gospel. They're not inspired by any stretch of the imagination, but these are some things that I've learned. Hopefully they can be some practical suggestions for you. And then let's walk through this passage very briefly together as an example. Before we get into that, a few books, if you're looking specifically to grow, two great books that I've found throughout the years. One is by Gordon Fee and Douglas Stewart. It's called How to Read the Bible for All It's Worth. You can find that on Amazon. And then the other one is Kay Arthur's Bible Study Method, which has really shaped the way that I've loved God's Word. And it's just simply called How to Study Your Bible. And both of these lay out an inductive study method, which that essentially means you start with the specific passage that you're reading or studying, and then you move to the surrounding chapters, and then that book of the Bible, and then maybe that specific author, and then the New Testament, and then the Bible. You start with the center of the bullseye and continue to move out, and that helps you really gain an understanding of specifically what does God's word have to say to us. And so if you take John 15, for example, abide is a concept that's going to come up in just a minute. So in this passage, how is abide used? And then where else do we see it in the book of John, in the Gospel of John? And then what about other writings of John? The first John has a lot to say about abide. And then where do we see that in other places in the New Testament? And what about in the Old Testament? And all of that helps you understand how John is using the word abide in this passage. And I have at times done some word studies, you know, maybe in a difficult time, I'm wanting to learn more about what God's word has to say about hope. And so you can search through a lot of different things. And I've used the free app, the ESV app on the phone. And it's a great way to just search for the word hope and then trace through the whole Bible. And where does God's word have to say hope? And then really glean from some of those things. But most of the time, for me, I find it the most beneficial to my soul and to understanding God's word to walk through a book of the Bible. And so usually I go slow through it. Maybe I'll read just a couple of chapters. Most of the time I'll just read one. Sometimes I'll just look at a couple of verses each time I sit down with God's word, like here in the book of John. So look with me, John 15. I'm just going to read real quick, John 15, 1 through 11. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done to you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." So you can see this is a very rich passage. This is something that I would probably spend several days on getting into it and studying. So we're not going to look at everything here, but I just want to point out a couple of things to keep in mind. First of all, look at the context. Whenever someone is saying something in God's word, think about what's coming right before it. So it just begins, "I am the true vine." So who's talking here? Well, we know by looking at the context that Jesus is talking. Who is he talking to? He was clearly talking to his followers here. Why are they saying this? There's lots of indicator words in God's word. If it starts with because or therefore, these words tip us off as to what is going on around this passage. We don't just rip open God's word. We look at the context of what's happening in God's word to help us understand what it means. Then look here at the metaphors. Now, does Jesus mean that he is a literal vine? Are we literally the branches? Well, of course not. So what does this metaphor teach us? Well, think about literal vine and literal branches for a moment. The branches are only alive when they're connected to the vine. Their life, their nutrition, their growth, their fruit, it's all dependent on the vine. So Jesus here is telling us that we are only as good as our connection to him. You see how these metaphors can help us understand the passage a little more. Also, look for imperatives. Look for key commands. We're told several times in this passage to abide in Jesus, to abide in my love. And then look for warnings. Look in verse 6. We're told, "If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers." So these are things to keep in mind as you're studying God's word. And then look for the reason it's written. Jesus tells us here at the end in verse 11, "These things I've spoken to you." This is amazing. He tells us exactly why he said all this. I've spoken these to you that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. Jesus is telling us the outcome of this whole thing. The reason I'm telling you this is so that you can have my joy and that it can be full. That helps us understand what this whole passage is about. And then look for key words or concepts that are repeated as you read through this, as we read through it together. I'm sure you heard over and over the words abide and the words fruit, and even the word love happens several times. So when you get to a passage of scripture and that's repeating, you know that that's something of critical importance. And I've used a bunch of different Bible marking methods and techniques throughout the years. It's really important to me to kind of mark up God's word. And so you can even see in my Bible, I've got like different colors. And I like to circle or underline some of those key words like that that stick out to me. I also want to just give you some helpful tools that I've used to underline and to mark. I've used these little pens. It's called a Pigma Micron 01 pen. You can find it on Amazon pretty easily. I love them because they're super, super thin. They don't bleed through Bible pages and they're very easy to write in the margins. The other thing currently that I use is this multicolored pencil. There's 8 different colors. It's called a Pentel Arts 8 color pencil. You can use this to mark different things. Currently, I mark Jesus with red and God the Father with blue and the Holy Spirit with yellow and verses of hope or encouragement in orange and commands in green. There's so many different things like that, ways that you can mark that. I use that throughout all of God's word so that you can kind of see some of those overarching themes. A couple other helpful tools, you know, obviously your Bible. I'm totally fine with an electronic Bible, but I have found in my study of God's word that an actual paper Bible is so much better for my soul. I'm able to, again, mark on it and write in the margins and mark little things and color things. And I'm able to even think about, when I think through passages, I'm able to remember where they are on the page. That's at the top right somewhere, and I can find that. The other thing I love about this is my wife, who's far more artistic than me, she will write in the margins. If you see some of this is John 15 for her. And you can see a lot of the really beautiful things she does, the markings for love and all those kind of things. There's lots of different ways that you can mark your Bible. But just keep in mind, your Bible is a workbook for you. So use, you know, pens and pencils and highlighters and all of those things. Mark and write in your Bible. It helps you understand God's word. I have found a lot of use for those electronic Bibles, for the ESV Bible app that's free on your phone. I use Olive Tree Bible Study on my computer a lot. There's Bible Gateway as a website. Whole lots of things like that that are helpful. Also, have a journal near you. These are super helpful to write down specifically what is God teaching me through this. Also, I use a study Bible. I'm quite fond of the ESV Study Bible. It is massive and very heavy, but I love the commentary that it has in the bottom and the maps that it includes. And before every book of the Bible, there's an explanation of it, all sorts of things like that. You can pick up commentaries if you want to delve deeper into some things. Dr. V will be really happy. This is one that I actually like a lot, the Moody Bible Commentary. It's the whole Bible in one unit, which is big, but it's the whole Bible, and I found that very helpful. I also like these. There's a InterVarsity Press Bible background commentary. So this will tell you a lot of the background that's going on in some of those. There's an Old Testament and a New Testament version. Those are all things if you want to kind of dig in deeper. You don't need all of that necessarily, but they can be helpful. Also, I really like audio Bibles from time to time. I use a thing called Streetlights, which is a free app. You can find it on any platform, Streetlights. And they just read the Bible over a beat. I run to it, and I love just filling my mind with God's word while I do those things. The last sort of tool that I can think of that's so helpful is to have a friend, have an accountability partner, and have someone who you are telling what God is teaching you in his word. It's one of the best ways that you can instill what he's teaching you is to communicate it to someone else. So don't forget in all this, I know I don't want this to be overwhelming, and I know it can sound that way when you start thinking of tools and thick commentaries and things like that, but the purpose of all of this is to meet with Jesus. You know, the book of James tells us that we need to be doers of the word, not just hearers only. So my goal, not just with John 15, but my goal with any passage of God's word is to abide in Jesus. It's to spend the time meeting with Jesus and to have my life changed because of my time with him. So spend that time each and every day thinking about that one simple question: what is God teaching me through his word today? I try to have one main thing from my time in God's word each day. One thing that he's speaking to me. Maybe it's a change that I need to make in the way that I really relate to others. Maybe it's a sin pattern that I need to put off. Maybe it's a reminder to trust him even when it's difficult. Whatever it is, have that thing that God is teaching you, and he'll use his word to continue to grow you to follow Jesus and to meet with him on a continual way. Hopefully some of these tips have been helpful to you. Please don't take any of them as requirements or check marks or gold stars if you do it right. These are simply what I have found as helpful as I try to meet with Jesus through God's word, and I hope it helps you too. Thanks, Arvis. You are loved.